I'm Betty. Welcome to Betty's Kitchen. Today we're making festive eggnog cake. And as you can tell, it's a seasonal recipe because it has eggnog, and we can find eggnog easily at the grocery now, but in the middle of summer, not necessarily. So we're going to start with a large bowl, and then we're going to add one stick of butter, which is 1/2 cup of butter, and that is softened. So I've had that sitting out for a while, so it'll be nice and workable. To the butter, we're adding 1 cup of white granulated sugar. Then we're going to use our mixer and beat this on low until it's light and fluffy. Now I have some ingredients that I'm going to add to our butter and sugar mixture. So I'm going to come over here and use this small bowl into which I am going to put 2 1/4 cups of all-purpose flour. That's 2 cups, and then here is the 1/4 cup. To that, I'm adding 1 teaspoon of baking soda, 1/4 teaspoon of salt, and 1/4 teaspoon of ground nutmeg. And just stir that together. And then we're ready to add some ingredients back to our butter and sugar mixture. We have 1 teaspoon of imitation rum flavoring, or it's just rum flavoring, but it's not the real stuff, it's imitation. So we'll just stir that in. And then the way we're going to add the other ingredients is to add part of the flour mixture, just as much as you'd like to do, and also some eggnog. I have 1 cup of eggnog here, so I'm just going to pour in part of that. Then blend this together and continue that process until our dry mixture and our eggnog have been incorporated. With our dry ingredients and eggnog combined into our mixture, we're ready to put in some maraschino cherries. These are chopped maraschino cherries, 1 cup. We're also going to put in 1/2 cup of chopped toasted almonds. You can see what I have here. These were almond slivers, and they were not toasted, but I put them in a small skillet over low heat and just turn them like this occasionally for about 5 minutes, and they got nice and tan, so they have a crunch to them and they have a very good flavor. 1/2 cup of chopped toasted almonds. And then mix that around until it's ready to put in a pan to bake. Now this goes to a baking pan, and we'll be baking this at 350 degrees. If you want to put it in a jelly roll pan and have a very thin layer, then you can bake it and cut it into squares and serve it like that. Since this is a little more festive, being for Christmas, I have chosen a specialty pan, which you probably won't have, but I'm just suggesting if you have something similar, you might want to do that. But I thought we would see how this looks if we go ahead and put our batter into a pan that has an unusual shape. So it's going to take a while for me to fill this, but I'm going to try to put all of the batter in, and then we'll bake it at 350 degrees just until a toothpick inserted at the deepest point comes out clean. Here is our festive eggnog cake, and it's been in the oven for 13 minutes, and I'm going to do the test on it because it just looks done. So we'll go toward the center that looks like the deepest part and put a toothpick in. It goes way down, but it's clean. So that means this is done. We want to let it cool until it's just warm, and we will be making a drizzle to put over the top, a little frosting or glaze, and it should be warm at the time we do that. So we'll be back to make that icing. Here's our festive eggnog cake after it is cool for about an hour. So it has some residual warmth in the center in particular, but you want to go ahead and glaze it when it's warm. Now you need to make a decision as to whether you want this side up, which I think looks really nice because it's kind of puffed on the sides here, and I don't think it would lie on that as well as the bottom that is actually down here. So that means I'll have to turn it over into a plate and then turn it over again to make it look just like this. So I'll show you how I'll do that. If I use a large plate, this is a cake plate, but it's not really quite large enough to hold all of this, and that was one reason I decided to double turn. But anyway, I have used this knife to go around all the edges and loosen them the best I can. So hopefully I've got it loose and it will detach from the pan and come to the plate. So here we go. Let's see what we've got. I'm going to have to press down a little bit on each one of these. And I feel them releasing, and that's what we have. So you can leave it like that if you like that look, but I'm going to take this larger plate and try not to compact it too much because it's very heavy, but just easily flip it over. And then I have it back right side up. And that's just my choice of how I like to do it. If you like the bottom side up, then of course you can leave it like that, and then you'll be making your glaze and you'll be glazing the bottom side. But ours is kind of put in place, and it's very hard to move after you've got it set. If it was worth it to me, I would move it down a little bit, but it's just, I don't want to tear it. So I'm going to go ahead and leave it and let it just cool a little bit more while I'm making a glaze. So I'll be back with my equipment to make the glaze. This is going to be the glaze for our festive eggnog cake. So I've got a medium-sized bowl, and into that I'm putting 3/4 cup of confectioner sugar. Some people call that powdered sugar or icing sugar. I'm going to add 1/2 teaspoon of rum flavoring. And then I'm going to add 3 to 4 teaspoons of milk. So we'll start with 3. And these are kind of scant. So I'll do 3.5, which is really about 3 altogether. And see if that's enough for it to cling together. Yes, it clings together, but it's more of an icing right now than it is a glaze. So let's put a little more milk in. And just a tiny amount, because a little goes a long way in a small mixture like this. So that's looking better. Now I am going to add some food coloring. Since we have such a festive cake, and it has those cherries, which are red, in it, I'm going to put a little green food coloring in. I don't necessarily want it forest green, really dark. It could be mint, but just something to give it some interest, and also the combination of red and green for Christmas. So this is pretty powerful, being the paste gel coloring. I already got it permanently on my finger. But I'm not going to put much in, but I am recognizing that it might change the consistency a little bit, so I've left myself some space to put more milk in if I need to. I don't think we need any more green than that. I think that's a pretty color of green to go with the red of the maraschino cherries. I would like it to be a little runnier, so it's no more milk, just drops at this point. We're almost there. scrape it down from the edges, and just look at the consistency. That will drizzle pretty well. So I think we're finished with that, and I don't want these dripping on the counter, so I'm going to move them over here into the sink, and then we will try to drizzle this over our cake. Now you need some kind of plan, and I haven't really thought about this much, but probably if we drizzle toward the center on each one of these rays, it might look nice. So let's try that. We can always cover it up. And that is the finished look of our festive eggnog cake. And I'll be back to take a taste of it. I want to show you how to serve the festive eggnog cake. Now, it depends on how many people you have, but there are 6 tips. So if you just have 6 people to serve, that's pretty easy to go in sixth. I would suggest that you do the same pattern, but cut each one in half if you've got 12 people. But it's very easy to see that if you take a serrated edge knife and cut down at this point, and then come over here and do the same thing, you have something that's very symmetric and very nice. And it has one of the design holes right there, so that's nice. Getting some of everything, got some drip over here, some drizzle. So we'll just take a pie server or cake server and get that piece and bring it over to our plate. Actually, I chose a plate that's kind of like a bowl, so it's not the best for the look here. I may move that to a different plate just for the looks, but I'll be back to take a taste. Now I have it on a flatter plate, so that makes me feel more comfortable. I'm gonna go over here to an edge. It does brown up a little at the edge, not much at all. And we'll get a little of the drizzle. That looks like a good bite. So here we go. Mmm. I forgot there were nuts in it. Those almonds that were toasted. Tastes really good. This is so moist. In fact, it's moist enough that I'm going to say, if you don't like something that's moist like this, then bake it maybe 5 more minutes, because it could have taken longer in the oven. But I didn't want to overdo it, so I got it out. But it's not like cake batter. It's just a very moist cake. I can go on, because this is an unusual flavor and it's an interesting cake. And I have my eggnog here, and I wanted to show you that we only use non-alcoholic additions in the cake and in the icing. And that was in the form of rum flavoring. So I put a bottle of rum out here just for people who might like to open it up and have their eggnog here and put a splash of rum and stir it in and then drink it that way. So maybe that would satisfy some of you that like to have the alcoholic edge. And if you want to substitute the rum flavoring by actual rum, you may do that. But I get so many comments from people who want a non-alcoholic dessert or beverage or whatever it might be. So I try to make it that way, but make it so you can change it if you want to be different. So I hope you enjoy this recipe. I had fun making it. I think you will enjoy making it. And it's it happened that I had a pan that was unusual. If you have anything kind of like that or unusual like that, you'll enjoy doing that. But if not, just make it plain. And the taste is that good that you'll want to do it.